Friends, welcome on behalf of the Lata Foundation and the India Vikas Center to this fourth memorial lecture named after Pandit Kumar Dinkar. We have had three lectures before, delivered by Mukund Lal, T.M. Krishna, and Vijay Kich. This is the fourth. Lata Foundation organizes every year 8 memorial lectures, one each of Kumar Gandhar, Kavi Tanveer, Kelucharan Mahapat, Mani Kaul, Agye, Daya Krishna, P.S. Kaitonde. And it's a hard task trying to find speakers, although we can call anybody from any part of the country, but it's very difficult. So one of the jobs that I perform as the managing trustee is to keep on looking and remembering. So I came across the name of Mr. Deepak Raja because I had a couple of his books with me. And I had never met him before. I met him for the first time yesterday. Or perhaps we have met, I don't remember.
Mr. P.K. Lahiri had first introduced me to you, and before that, my Guruji.
Okay. And it so turned out that he is a disciple of a very dear friend of mine, Pandit Arvind Parikh, the another eminent disciple of Ustad Vilayat Khan. He, of course, as you perhaps know, he had written quite widely discussed books on music, and they are Hindustani Music, A Tradition in Transition, Khayal Vocalism, Continuity Within Change, Hindustani Music Today, and the fourth book, which is likely to come next month, is The Ragness of Raga, which is also the theme of today. He has been awarded many distinctions, and he has been a consulting musicologist for many well-known international organizations. I happen to have, and some of you in the audience have known Kumar Gandhar personally. And I remember in this context two of his statements. One of them was, "Raag to nanga hota hai, hum kapde pehnate." This is one which he used to say. And the other he used to say, "Ke main to maran dharma कला का साधक हूँ, गाते गाते रोज मरता हूँ, जो तिलक का मोर जिस कुमार गंधर्व ने गाया वो दोनों मर चुके, फिर कुमार जी गाएंगे, कभी कभी कुमार जी अपने को थर्ड पर्सन की तरह भी एड्रेस करते थे, फिर कुमार जी गाएंगे, लेकिन वो दूसरा तिलक का मोर होगा और वो दूसरे कुमार गंधर्व होंगे। तीसरा उनका एक वक्तव्य था, असल में जिसको हम राग कहते हैं वो सिर्फ एक प्रोफाइल है, एक इट्स अ काइंड ऑफ अ ब्रॉड प्रोफाइल, उसको फिर उसमें रंग हम भरते और उसको एक पोर्ट्रेट हम बनाते। सो देयर वाज दिस वाइल ट्रेडिशन गिव्स यू द राग, देयर इज दिस इंडिविजुअल टैलेंट व्हिच मेक्स इट व्हाट इट अल्टीमेटली टर्न्स आउट टू बी इन द वॉइस or in the hands of a great musician. इसके पहले कि दीपक राजा साहब अपना व्याख्यान शुरू करें, हम बहुत आभारी हैं अविनाश पसरीचा के। वो ऐसा शास्त्रीय संगीत और शास्त्रीय नृत्य की दुनिया में शायद ही कोई होगा जो अविनाश पसरीचा की फोटोग्राफी से आक्रांत न हुआ हो या उसका शिकार न बना हो, वगैरह वगैरह। तो उन्होंने एक छोटी सी फिल्म बनाई थी बरसों पहले, संभवतः मार्जी की किसी 75वीं वर्ष क्या, तो वो दिखाएंगे, पहले आप वो देखेंगे, उसके बाद श्री दीपक राजा, और वो चाहते थे कि वो बैठ के बोले, तो बैठ के बोलेंगे कि उनका अंदाज थोड़ा बाकी वाला होगा।
Years ago, the child prodigy Shivaputra Siddaramaiah Kumkari took the music world by storm and was hailed by connoisseurs as Kumar Gandharva. Today, Kumar Gandharva is 60. Chaotic life of big cities. His gracious home, named Bhanukul, nestles at the foot of a hill, on top of which is perched the temple of Mata Chamundi. Kumarji's friends, students and admirers all flock to the score of graceful harmony. Here, in the midst of his family, his wife Vasundharaji, daughter Kalapini, son Mukul and grandson Bhuvan, Kumarji continues his quest into music and literature, absorbing the minutest details of the life around him. These find unified creative expression in his compositions.
Thank you.
born in Karnataka to Sri Siddaramaiah and his wife. Kumarji found a teacher in the renowned musicologist Professor B. R. Devdhar, himself a leading disciple of Pandit Vishnu Digambar Paluskar. At Devdhar School of Indian Music, young Kumar, as an enthusiastic organizer of musical soirees, came across many a stalwart, as well as the then budding talents, among them Pandit V.G. Jog. Begum Akhtar. Pandit Ravi Shankar and Ustad Ali Akbar Khan. Kumarji at Uday Shankar's Almora Center was perhaps the youngest celebrity in the galaxy of renowned musicians. During these years, Kumarji found a companion in Bhanumati Kaums. Whom he subsequently married. Their son, Mukul, in the footsteps of his father, not unexpectedly, began singing at an early age. Invitations to perform started pouring in from all corners of the country. And during the bedridden years, Kumarji achieved a rare and deep insight into the folk music of Malwa. Kumarji's first concert, after 5 long years of silence, was attended by none other than Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru himself. Vasundhara Shrikhande, an able disciple who has since partnered him in life as in his music. Kumarji's creative genius manifested itself in the many compositions that he created in already existing rags and composite programs. Words can hope to be, of the intensity of the response he has generated for 5 decades. It is a recognition of the power of his music, which has been felt by generations of music lovers.
Trustees of the Raza Foundation and friends. I'm most grateful to the Raza Foundation for inviting me to do this lecture. It is an honor that no one in his right mind would have refused. I had a choice between speaking in English and Hindi. I have chosen to speak in English, predominantly in English, because some of the ideas that I wish to discuss probably become untranslatable into Hindi. And yet, I suppose, Hindi being the language in which we've understood music, Hindi being the language in which we've interacted with great musicians, I will drift into Hindi, forgetting the fact that someday a video of this might go international. The present audience here is far more important to me than a global audience that I might one day reach. Before I start, I pray to my gurus that every word of mine does justice to their wisdom. Thank you, sir, for allowing me to sit and speak. And there's a very good reason for my asking for this permission. I have no problem standing for 2 hours and speaking, as you can see. I find that my tone of voice changes substantially when I sit and address, because I'm at the same level as the audience, or at least close to it, and I don't consider myself having the stature yet to talk down to an audience. So with your permission, I will continue while seated. I must start by telling you how I started working on this subject. About 15 years ago, I had to write a commentary on a recording of my Ustad Vilayat Khan Sahab. I was doing a review of 13 recordings that he had recorded for India Archive Music in New York. One of them, as I came to that recording, foxed me totally. For 50 years, I've been a disciple of that gharana, interacted a good deal with Khan Sahab himself. And I found it very, very difficult to come to terms with that recording, to understand it, to be able to write intelligently on it. It was the most unorthodox music, packaged in the most orthodox format. And I said to myself, where do I begin? Where do I start writing about it? How do I interpret this music for an international global reader? So I went to Professor Ashok Ranade, who was an eminent musicologist and my senior and my guide whenever I needed him. And I asked him, sir, can you please go through this and tell me what to do with it? How do I make sense of this recording? It's a great piece of recording, great piece of music, perhaps one of the greatest pieces of music I've heard in the last 50 years of instrumental music. So he said, leave it with me overnight, come back tomorrow morning. He heard it. Next morning when I went back to him, he tells me, focus on the rag tattva. Once you get a grip on rag tattva, everything else will fall into place. So I said, ye rag tattva kya cheez hoti hai bhai? Where does it begin and where does it end? He says that you go and figure it out yourself. He wasn't a man, he wasn't a guide who would spoon feed anyone. And that's when this search started. And it's on. I'm still trying to figure out where Rag Tattva begins and where it ends. I'm not going to deal with the grammar so much. Where Rag begins, once you put aside the grammar, this is basically the scope of my search. I chose this topic for several reasons. One is that in my last book, which is called Raganes of Ragas, I have dealt with some of the explorations of mine in this territory. Some of the ideas I broached there were half-baked at that time, and I didn't get into too much detail. Since then, I have had a good deal of time to think about them, research them out a little more thoroughly. So I thought this was a good occasion to do so. Second, Rag Tattva is so fundamental to Hindustani music that Hindustani music is Rag music. So it's worth talking about it. And if you go back into the history of Indian musicology, 80 out of 100 books written on Hindustani music are called Rag something. So raga is the core of our Hindustani musical tradition. So it's worth looking at it afresh anytime, in any way one can. The third reason, of course, is Kumarji himself. It's very difficult to discuss the notion of raga without actually discussing Kumarji's handling of the raga. And Professor Ranade did say to me that very day, he said there's something uniquely Indian about a musician's relationship with his art. And I think the notion of the raga or the phenomenon of the raga is at the core of this. You go and figure it out. How far does it go? How far can your mind go? How far can this exploration go? So this is by way of an introduction to my subject. Now, there are so many different ways of looking at a raga. All of them are obviously interrelated. And yet, because one needs to approach them from different angles, a totally sequential flow of ideas isn't always possible. So the best you can expect is a collage of ideas, which I think helped me to understand what a raga is beyond its melodic grammar. My presentation also will probably seem to you like a little bit like a Godard film. It has a beginning and a middle and an end, but not necessarily in that order, because that is the nature of the subject I am handling. It's not a jigsaw puzzle, but it could well be a collage. I will start with the most familiar, the most clinical way of looking at a raga. Raga is a set of rules governing selection, sequencing, and intonation. Intonation is a huge area. I don't want to go into it in detail. Now, this basic clinical definition has been the basis for a couple of other derivative definitions. And I don't need to spend more than 1 minute on the basic clinical definition, because we have to go beyond the grammar. It's been called a melodic matrix for composition and improvisation. This was a description given by Professor S.K. Saxena, who was my professor at Hindu College, very eminent aesthetician. And some foreign scholars of Hindustani music have preferred to call it partially composed melody. These are both derived from the fact that there's a set of rules governing selection, sequencing, and intonation. Now, we go back to the root to see what the Shastra has to say. I'm looking at a description of 800 AD. Raga is born from the act of coloring or delighting. The word raga is derived from ranjan, Sanskrit verb, which means to tinge or to color. Then, that which colors the mind of the good through specific swara and varna, or through types of dhvani, is known by the wise as raga. The emphasis on mind. Why was this necessary? And Professor Saxena, again in his latest work, comes with a very interesting observation that when you define the good and the wise as the appropriate audience for a raga, you're saying that the communicative content of the raga, the communicative intent of the raga, is understood only by those who are cultivated in the knowledge of the raga. So it is basically, to interpret this definition, the raga is a melodic representation of an emotional idea. As you know, the word raga doesn't have any melodic meaning in Sanskrit at all. It has only an emotional meaning. Its emotional charge is delivered through the artistic prowess of the musician. and the emotional charge is accessible only to those good and wise, those cultivated in rag music. From this I infer that music is an emotional language, the raga is an admittedly restrictive linguistic device for communicating emotional ideas. And I will repeatedly refer to this issue of restrictive because it differentiates it from popular music and folk music and other forms of music. And it is admittedly restrictive. Now you might say a definition of 800 AD is not relevant. No, not quite true. Because by 800 AD, the Alapti form of presentation, which was the Raga Alapti and the Rupaka Alapti forms, which were substantially improvised, were already in circulation. And they're documented in Sangeet Ratnakar of the 12th, 13th century. So it's not that it was there was no improvisation in music. Therefore one may assume that the rag itself has reached a substantial level of abstraction by then. It wasn't just pre-composed music. Although it's possible that pre-composed music was substantially the dominant form at that time. So when I just define it as a language, because any communication device which is restrictive becomes a language. A language is meant only for people who know that language, who are cultivated in that language. A language, I'm sorry, I have to take you into a little bit of linguistics theory because it's relevant to, and I'm trying to put it as simply as I can, because this goes into cognitive science, and that's not the easiest thing to handle. I'm putting it very simply, and I'm using concepts that I've learned in my years in advertising and in the communications industry. Because it's a voluntary device, it's used when the user has a purpose. And very simply put, the purpose is to elicit a response, which may be in the nature of accepting or rejecting information, confirming an or altering belief, activate an emotion or feeling, or trigger action. These are the four simple purposes for which human beings communicate in any language. One might say that any music is a specialist language for activating the emotions, and that would probably be true. But the raga music, where does it fit into our understanding of language, which is a voluntary device used by people to communicate emotional ideas? I'll take this argument a little further. How a language works. Of all the definitions of the language, I found Chomsky's definition most fascinating. And Chomsky, as you know, is one of the most influential voices in linguistics in the recent past. A language communicates through statements of finite length, incorporating a finite number of patterns assembled from a finite set of sounds arranged in a predictable sequence. This could as well be a definition of a rag. Now, how does a language communicate? To elaborate it further, now we are getting into really cognitive science. There is the theory of meaning. There's acoustic or phonetic meaning, which is the meaning of the sounds. Lexical meaning, which is the meaning of the words. Syntactical meaning, which is related to the sequencing of words. And referential meaning, which is derived from other statements, other than the statements other than the one that you're making. Do words in a raga have a meaning at all? This is the question that we have come across whenever we have read work on music. And there's an objection raised by people who are experts on linguistics. Why do I say they object to music being called a language? Because it does not support the notion of a lexical meaning. Lexical meaning means the meaning of words, something you can look up in a dictionary or a thesaurus. I believe that even in a spoken language or a written language, the relationship between the communicative intent and its reception is never any way close to 100%. That's why you have something like a thesaurus, which gives you synonym. If you know a little bit of Latin, you'll know the word synonym means similar to. It's not the same thing. When you open a dictionary or a thesaurus, you get 10, 15, 20 things which suggest the meaning of a word, but they are not the word itself. So I'm arguing that the difference between a linguistic statement and a musical statement as a rag is merely in the nature of probabilities. When we make a linguistic statement, we are 80% sure that the communicative intent is being understood. When you make a musical statement as a rag, you're probably 50% sure. And of course, less than 50%, you wouldn't perform that rag. And there are rags where the communicative intent is blurred and they go out of circulation. So I would define a language as a proven theory of communication because it has a high probability of eliciting the kind of response you want. And a raga more as a psychoacoustic hypothesis, which you may say has a minimum of 50% probability of being understood. So in the case of rag music, I would say the objection to not accepting music as a language is a weak objection. Why do I call it a psychoacoustic hypothesis? A hypothesis, even in the exact sciences, is not arbitrary. It is based on astute speculation, or it is based on critical observation. There is a stimulus-response relationship, there is a cause and effect relationship established in the tradition, which allows you to say, if I sing this rag, or if I perform this rag, I am delivering, and if you're doing it competently, I am delivering a certain range of emotional ideas. I can't say it's one idea, but nor can you say it in a language. You're delivering a certain range of meanings. And the important thing about calling it a hypothesis is that every hypothesis wants to move towards becoming a theory, because every hypothesis wants to maximize the probability of a response. Now, how does a rag as a hypothesis seek its own conversion into a theory? How does it accumulate evidence to come closer to achieving the emotional response that it wants to do? It does it by, and that's why I say that it is a perennial hypothesis. A rag is a perennial hypothesis. It never wants to become a theory. Each performance reshapes the cultural, and this evidence is drawn from the cultural memory. I would have preferred to use racial memory, but some of my friends said race is not a respectable word today, so I dropped that idea. But to use strictly Jungian logic of Carl Gustav Jung, yes, it would be called the racial memory or the collective memory, whatever you want to call it. So a rag is a hypothesis that never wants to become a theory. It is repeatedly performed in hundreds of different ways. As Bajpayee Sahib spoke about, Kumarji mentioned, ki aage bhi tilakka mod hoga aur aage bhi Kumarji gayenge, par wo tilakka mod alag hoga aur raag Kumarji bhi alag honge. It is a perennial hypothesis that never wants to become a theory. Now, what really happens? Each performance actually reshapes the cultural memory. It's like a bank. You're drawing melodic ideas from the cultural memory into your performance. And in the process, you're also contributing some ideas to the cultural memory, which are new. So ever so imperceptibly, every performance is actually altering or reshaping that cultural memory. And that is what a performance is. And what Kumarji says is exactly that. Each time I'm trying to get closer to Tilakka Mod. this brings us to the notion that the rag, as we understand, is a consensual entity. निराकार आकृति तो है पर सर्वमान्य निराकार आकृति है उसमें एक सर्वमान्य स्वरूप भी है सो व्हाट इज द कॉन्सेंशुअल एंटिटी द सम टोटल मेलोडिक आइडियाज एवर डिप्लॉयड इन द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ अ राग आई विल वेरी ब्रीफली नरेट हियर अ कन्वर्सेशन आई हैड विद माय उस्ताद विलायत खान साहब आई सेड खान साहब राग कितना बड़ा होता है एक दिन उन्होंने कह दिया ये राग बहुत बड़ा होता है यार मैंने कहा कितना बड़ा होता है बोलते तुम्हारी इमेजिनेशन से बहुत बड़ा होता है तो मैंने कहा और कितना बड़ा होता है कि तुम्हारी उस्ताद की इमेजिनेशन से भी बड़ा होता है तो मैंने कहा और कितना बड़ा होता है तो बोले दुनिया में जितने संगीतकार पैदा हुए हैं और जो और भी पैदा होने वाले हैं वो सबकी इमेजिनेशन से बड़ा होता है तो मैंने कहा फिर राग खत्म कहाँ होता है उसकी सरहद कहाँ है तो उन्होंने कहा राग की सरहद वहाँ है जहाँ वो दूसरे राग की सरहद में ना पहुँच जाए वहाँ उसकी सरहद है तो दिस इज द नोशन ऑफ द राग एज अ कॉन्सेंशुअल आइडेंटिटी एंड आई लाइक टू गिव द एनालॉजी ऑफ द स्टॉक मार्केट इन दिस आई मीन आई एम एन MBA मेकिंग अ लिविंग एज अ फाइनेंशियल कंसल्टेंट सो आई होप यू डोंट माइंड It behaves much like the stock market. Isolated individual trades are happening all the time and influencing the price. And in this case, the aesthetic value or the melodic values attached to a rag. But the price itself is a consensus which is influencing, in turn, the individual trades of the investors. And we have often heard it said, those of us who invest in the stock market, the market has a mind of its own. And manipulation of the market is not considered feasible for long because it has a mind of its own. So I often like to draw the analogy of a consensual identity of a rag with the way the stock market behaves in relation to individual trades. And there is an individual musician performing today. He is contributing some ideas to that consensus. He's drawing some ideas to that consensus. In that process, the consensus is changing beyond his control. The consensus has a mind of its own. And comparing it to the stock market a little further, I'll take this argument. It can be taken much further. I'll take it just one step further. The motivation is self-interest, just as it is in the stock market. A musician is an economic being. He has to remain aesthetically relevant, like an investor. He is a financial being, and he has to remain relevant as an investor. So both are acting in economic self-interest. And that is how we come to the notion of a rag as a dynamic consensus. But there is, of course, a divergent view, and of course there must be, which is a commanding form. The commanding form idea was first introduced in Western music by Professor Susan Langer, one of the most, probably the most influential aesthetician in the US. And with reference to Western music, she took the view that the composition in Western music is the commanding form and forms the basis of all the elaboration and the development in the performance. Professor Saxena, as some of you might know, was a great admirer of Professor Langer's work. And Professor Saxena said, in Hindustani music, I do not consider the composition as the commanding form. It is the rag that is the commanding form of Hindustani music, because it performs the supervisory function for everything that happens in performance. Now, some musicians have said that you cannot ignore the composition in Hindustani music as a participant in creating the consensus. That's a different issue. I don't want to get into that debate at the moment. So there is one view that the market, stock market, has a mind of its own. The other is the market is nothing but an aggregation of individual trades. So there is one notion of a consensual entity, rag as a consensual entity, and there's another notion of rag as a commanding form which almost has an autonomous existence. How do we reconcile this? And the reconciliation has to be, I suppose, predictably, relying on the essential transcendentalism of the Indian mind. Again, I will quote my conversation with Vilayat Khansal on this subject. He said, yaar, sari zindagi hum raag ki sadhana karte rehte hain, ibadat karte rehte hain. Is umeed mein ke zindagi mein ek baar राग की झलक दिख जाए हमें और शायद जिंदगी में एक ही बार जिस दिन अल्लाह मेहरबान हो जाए उस दिन वो झलक मिल जाती है तो उस दिन हमें कहते हैं कि एक संगीतकार का जीवन सफल हो गया. सो देर इज एन एसेंशियल ट्रांसेंडेंटलिज्म विच रेकनसाइल्स दिस व्यू ऑफ अ कॉन्सेंशियल आइडेंटिटी दैट म्यूजिशियंस हैव देमसेल्व्स बिल्ट एंड something above that, an autonomous entity which supervises this entire process of music. And the transcendentalism comes through very clearly in what Somnath says in Rag Vibhut, 17th century document. It says, the Rag Rupa is of two kinds, Nadatma, whose essence is sound, and Devmai, whose essence is an image incarnating the deity. Of the former there are many shapes, but of the latter there is only one. So rag is here clearly visualized as a deity. And therefore what happens to performance? Then performance is a prayer to the rag, the presiding deity of the rag, entreating it to descend into its melodic form. Rag ki ek jhalak dikh jaye, jis din Allah meherban ho. Zindagi mein shayad ek baar ye naseeb ho. That is the idea that essential transcendentalism of the Indian mind reconciles these two notions. I want to go a little further into this area of ragas as deities. And going back again to the reference that Bajpayee Sahib made of Kumarji's mention, somebody sent me a very interesting news item some time ago. Which said that a 3,000-year-old image of Bhagwan Sri Vishnu had been discovered in a temple in Cambodia. And the first thing that came to my mind is, how the hell did they recognize Vishnu? That it was Vishnu and no other deity. It was recognized that it by the fact that it had four hands and it had Shankh, Chakra, Gada and Padma. And that is how Vishnu was identified. I infer from that, for 3,000 years, somewhere in the Indian cultural memory, there is an image of a preserver of the universe, which has four hands and Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma. Now Vishnu, as you all know, as Vishnu Sahasranam, there are 1,000 attributes. Over these 3,000 years or more, millions of artists have sculpted and painted Lord Vishnu using many other attributes, but Shankha Chakra Gada Padma ke bina Bhagwan Vishnu nahi bante. To raag ke bhi yahi idea hai ke when you consider a raag as a deity, then you have identifying features and lot of peripheral features, as Bajpayee Sahib just said. In fact, very interestingly, Kumarji himself used to describe rag as a nirakar akruti, which would perfect any deity's description. Absolutely, it would fit any deity's description. It is nirakar akruti. So, to take this argument a little further, and the moment you talk of deities, you have to move towards considering whether the Jungian notion of archetypes is relevant to understanding rags. What are archetypes? They are collectively inherited formless images, universally present in the human psyche, manifested as recurring symbols in dreams, mythology, and art. In fact, Jung considered them psychological organs, which were fundamental to human evolution, just like physiological organs. And interestingly, their manifestation in art assures widespread and universal acceptance. So this is the Freudian notion of archetypes. Can we consider the rag an archetype? I believe we can. I want to come next to the issue, because all this is relevant to the point I'm moving towards discussing Kumarji specifically later, towards the end. Are these archetypes universal or culture specific? Jung treated them as universal with specific reference to the rag. My view is that they are culture specific. My view, I stand open to correction or debate on this. There may be some people who disagree, especially foreign scholars of Hindustani music. I checked out with one and he disagreed violently with me. I would make a distinction here. The consensual entity can have universal appeal, can have universal accessibility. The archetypal entity cannot. To understand Shankha Chakra Gada Padma and four arms as Vishnu is something that comes to the Indian mind more easily, and I'll come to a few more examples. The other question is that we've, right from the beginning, we have said the rag is an admittedly restrictive communication device. If you isolate the adept performer from the cultivated listener, a certain decontextualization is taking place. And the moment you decontextualize it, some meaning is lost. And I believe that meaning, the lost meaning, is the difference between the consensual entity, which may have universal appeal, and the culture-specific appeal, which is basically archetypal, understanding a rag as more than the melody, understanding the rag as associated with so many different aspects of culture that a person outside this culture cannot easily relate with. I'll give you a couple of examples here. I am not going to take very long now. Let's take the notion of seasonal rags, for instance. I'm taking a very pointed example of Bahar and Malhar. Both are seasonal rags. What are the signature phrases? The same signature phrase of both rags, Nida Nisa. What does Bahar stand for? Relief from the cruel heat of North Indian summers. What does Malhar stand for? Relief from the cruel heat of the Indian summers. And Bahar stands for relief from the severe winters of North India. Why should Nida Nisa, the same phrase, suggest a euphoric idea to us? And can I expect that a Japanese person or a Swedish person will relate it to them, relate to them the way I do? I'll give you another example, since Vajpayee Sahib has given me a little more time. Take our notion of Sandhi Prakash Rags. Komal Rishabh, Komal Daivat, they define the Sandhi Prakash Rags. Why? Sandhi Prakash is Suryoday and Suryast. An American, a Japanese, or a Swede will perfectly deliver a Sandhi Prakash rag, a Todi, or any of these rags for you. Rag is a rag. Rag to ho jayega, par gana bajana hoga kya? And why am I saying this? The Gayatri Mantra is supposed to be recited at Suryoday, at noon, and at sunset. The Sandhi Prakash time The twilight zone is also called the Godhuli Bela in several Indian languages. What a beautiful image. It's the time at which the cows kick up dust on their way to the pastures at sunrise and kick up dust again on their way back home at sunset. It is also true that at sunrise and at sunset, the whole family in the tradition that we were brought up in gathers around the temple together for an aarti. In several parts of the country, even today, it is the practice that you have a matka in the kitchen, even where fridges are there, which is always kept full, and at sunset a lamp is lit there. And I had once asked my mother, why do we do this? She says, in Gujarat especially, and probably true in some other parts of the country, that the spirits of the ancestors may be thirsty in the evening, and they would come home to drink water. So that pitcher is kept, and the lamp is kept next to the pitcher as a form of welcome, and to tell them where, because we are talking of a tradition that arose before electricity came. So the lamp is kept there to show the spirits where the water is. These are uniquely Indian ideas. Can anybody relate, can anybody outside this tradition relate to these ideas of the Sandhi Prakash Rag? So Komal Rishabh Daivat is not just a melodic framework. Komal Rishabh Daivat is a whole culture. This is one idea. So I've just given you these two examples to express, to support my view that if we are treating the rag as archetypal entities, they're culture-specific entities. Basic question, of course, then is that with what confidence do we make these statements? How did rags evolve? I'll consider the mathematical argument first. One day a mathematician sat down, took 12 notes, worked out all permutations, combinations, factorial 12, 12 into 11 into 10 into 9 into 8, right down to 2, and came up with 23.95 crore ascending descending patterns. And there are some bandishes where they refer to unchas koti rag, unchas koti tans. Unanchas koti tans. Now 23.95 ka double kare to unanchas nahi hota hai. Uska arithmetic I have to figure out unanchas koti tan kaha se aaya hai. But can they be called rags? A rag is not just a scale. This is one way, an extremely clinical mathematical way of saying a mathematical, and today a computer programmer will sit down and generate as many rags as you want. And they would go up to 23.9, close to 24 crore rags, if you want to call them rags. On the other side, at the other extreme, I will argue there's an organic evolution. And I'm now coming to the focus of my discussion on Kumarji's music. Rags evolved from songs. And songs, I'm saying not in lowercase s, but in capital S. What is a song? Song is a stable construct of poetry, melody, and rhythm, requiring no validation beyond its direct appeal to the heart. Here I want to draw a distinction between a song, as in song, and a bandish, as in Hindustani music. Professor Ranade has argued extremely convincingly in his glossary of Hindustani music that a bandish may satisfy you as an independent piece of music on its own, but that is not its primary purpose. A bandish is composed as an enabler and a facilitator of the rag vistar. So a bandish is composed for a musical function, while a song is not composed for a musical function, though it may have been set to tune. And here I go back to Suzanne Langer's observation, very interesting one, that the moment you put you compose a poem into song, It has surrendered its literary function to its musical function. You may or may not agree with this, but that is her view, and that is the distinction I am drawing between a song and a bandish. And this is true. In fact, this is one of the reasons why khayal music tolerates such mediocre poetry. Because it wasn't composed for literary purpose, it was composed for musical function. It gives you the consonants and the vowels you need for the extra elongated intonations and abbreviated intonations. It gives you the rhythm and the texture that you want for rag vistar. It's not meant to stand on its own. That's not why it was composed, or some of them may have been originally songs. And what really happened is, somebody composed a song which was brilliant in catching the imagination of people. Somehow it connected with the racial memory or the cultural memory, whichever word you prefer. The next poet, he also wanted his song to be very popular. So he says, yeah, I should also compose a song, something like that. He did that and it worked. So more or less similar songs started getting composed. And some learned man, like Professor Ranade or any of these great scholars, came and said, these are more or less similar. Can we abstract from them the principles? In statistical terms, you would call it communality. What is common to them? Can we organize that knowledge so that you can easily replicate, anybody can sing those and achieve more or less similar results? So a certain process of abstraction started taking place on what were originally songs. Otherwise, why would you have four different rags coming from the Bhupali scale? Why would you have 7-8 different rags coming from the Kedar scale? It's not a scale, it was once a song which got codified into a certain kind of melodic emotional statement. Now this whole idea of a song is crucial to understanding Kumarji's music. So there's an abstraction taking place all the time. When I come to understanding Kumarji's raganess, I look back on the history of Hindustani music as it prevailed around the time he was emerging on the scene. Very interesting, he came on the scene in the post-1950s, 1960s onwards period. The historical backdrop is interesting. Hindustani music during the Mughal period and the feudal period, which is the colonial feudal period, had become, because of the quality of the patronage it had, had achieved a good deal of intellectualization. And two specific concepts I would discuss here is, Kirana Gharana was the ascendant Gharana once the Gwalior and the Jaipur Gharanas receded, which was post-1950. They were the mother Gharanas who concentrated on broad spectrum appeal. Around the 50s or 60s, Kirana people came up with a very powerful system for intellectualizing rag vistar. They took simple rags in which rag vistar could be done almost mathematically. Jaipur came up with a totally different formula. They intellectualized the rag itself. So these two very strong intellectualizing forces were coming up around the time Kumarji was coming up. It was also the time when radio was expanding, gramophone records were expanding, and feudal patronage was ending, public performances, the public audiences were growing. The time was ripe for somebody to say, this intellectualization does not work. He was in that sense maybe ahead of its time because he didn't acquire a very large following, although he had tremendous influence on the music community. Kumarji did what I believe he did. He reconnected the raga to its origins, to the song from which they came, and therefore established an instant connect with the racial memory or the collective memory or the cultural memory, what you might call it. He sang bandishes like songs. Did he respect the consensual personality of the rags? Yes, but not always. Did he respect traditional bandishes? Yes, but not always. Was his intonation in line with the dominant norm at that time? Yes, but not always. So his notion of a performance was that he converted every bandish into a song before he performed it. And what happens when you conform a bandish into a song? Then your protocol for rag vistar also changes. So he did away, the moment he did away with the protocol also. So his architecture became very, well, you might call it maverick, yes it was. And that's one of the reasons why he's become inimitable. Because if you see the great inimitable musicians of our time, who were great original musicians of our time, who acquired a following like Ustad Amir Khan Sahib or Kishori Amonkar, their style could be carried forward because their architecture was very formal. And here I go back to Mr. Mohan Nadkarni's definition of traditional khyal music. He called it the formal aloofness of khyal. Kumarji dispensed with both formalism as well as aloofness. Now some people call it, call his music a tribalism, because he rediscovered rags from tribal folk regional music. He sang traditional rags and rediscovered rags from the songs of Malwa. But basically what he did was he liberated khyal from its formal aloofness, formalism as well as aloofness. And considering the small audience that he had, he may not have acquired great historical significance except for the tremendous impact of what he achieved. Because he connected Hindustani music once again probably with that archetypal store of cultural memory. And that is what explains his relevance even today. And I have known it from some of the senior most musicians in the country that every recording of Kumarji that came out was assiduously, seriously studied by their families for what it was saying that was fundamental to our music. In spite of its maverick quality, they studied his music. I need not give you names, but yes, I discussed Kumarji with several senior musicians. Yes, some of them said, I don't like it. Some of them say, yes, I like him very much. You can't be neutral about Kumarji, because he was ahead of its times. At that time, he seemed like a maverick and dismissible, or he seemed like a revolutionary, a man with a revolutionary insight into the fundamentals of music, and therefore is to be respected and studied. He obliged the khyal world to question its aesthetic assumptions. What is this formal aloofness all about? I had the occasion to discuss some of the issues that now I'm discussing critical theory with Professor Danade, because in his earlier work he had used words like modernism, romanticism, these ideas which came from Western critical theory. And in some of my early writings, I had described Kumarji's music as part of the Romanticist movement. And he said to me, try to avoid using these words because they come from a totally different context. I mean, today's people looking at Kumarji's music today might even describe him as postmodernist. Again, and people attempted to use that kind of word. I have used romanticism in one of my essays on Kumarji. I'm not comfortable with any of these ideas. Kumarji was an original. I can't even call him a revivalist, actually, in that sense. He was a total original who created a new model of musicianship. And what he did to bhajans, again, bhajans are songs. And he gave them a life that to this day, Kumarji's bhajans are much more in circulation than his style of khyal. And outside his gharana, musicians of all gharanas are singing Kumarji's bhajans the way he sang them. Some of them laughable caricatures, but that's okay. His bhajans survive. So this, I mean, I've gone through a lot of juxtaposition of connected, unconnected, jigsaw puzzle ideas to come to the point that Kumarji thought about raganess, about rag tattva, and did to rag tattva, which was ahead of its times. And that's precisely why it's impossible to discuss a rag tattva without reference to Kumarji's music. Thank you very much, all of you, for listening so patiently. My apologies, sir, for delaying your dinner.
Well, we have some time for any comments or any questions. Let them be brief. If there are questions, let them be sharp. Yes?
Rag is, in other sense, worship. Rag is, in other sense, worship as prayer to the divine. Now question is raised, what relation between rag with worship? Say some more.
Rag with worship, a connection, I think you would find. I think a direct connection you will probably find only in the seva traditions of the Vaishnav temples, where they prescribed different pads of Krishna Leela to be performed at different times of the day. That direct connection between worship and rags is probably to be found only in that sense. But here we are discussing the concept that rag itself is a deity. And when I am performing that rag, I am praying to that deity to please descend into my melodic expression. I am requesting the deity to descend into its manifest or manifest itself in my music. So, you know, I'll give you an example. I will quote Karlheinz Stockhausen, one of the most influential European composers. He died a couple of years ago. And he wrote something very interesting about Indian music, Hindustani music. He said when a Hindustani musician goes onto the stage to perform, his entire approach and stance is not that he is going to sit there and entertain you. He goes there and presents his music as if he is doing holy service. So that sense of reverence that with which we come, because we are dealing with, see, finally it all boils down to Nirakar Akruti. With an intense involvement in the Sakar or Sagun, we achieve a union with the Nirakar and the Nirgun. And this is not only a Hindu idea. I am very reliably told by somebody who I need not name, but impeccable, that Ustad Nasir Aminuddin Dagar at a seminar many years ago said, if a Drupad Gayak kisi ko hona hai, to Krishna Bhakt hona zaruri hai. Now, we may or may not agree with this statement, but I can appreciate the point he was making. Because if you are going to sing a Krishna Pad in Drupad, for God's sake, feel the Krishna Leela to be able to sing that with conviction. So, a direct relationship between worship and a rag you will find in the temples. But the rag itself, here is the deity. When I'm performing, it's a worship. It is an entreaty to the deity of the rag to descend into my music.
Yes. Anybody else?
Sir, I have a question. What was the fundamental contribution of Kumarji in the classical music? So Kumarji has put it. What is the reinvention of Tanpuras? If you look at the Swaratishchiti which he did in Dirvi Ragas, one of the fundamental contributions of Kumarji to Indian classical music, especially to the Raganes, the concept which you are talking about, was reinvention. himself, sir. To give you an example, suppose you take his Bhimpalas. The unique nishad of Bhimpalas which he used to apply, either in Vakechava or Ayurangafag, or any of his kalas of Bhimpalas, was practically invented out of the Tanpura. That's what he has gone on to say, it is on record. Take Todi for example. Jajare Patikava, Jaivat of Jajare Patikava, you could see in his Tanpura. You have not spoken anything about this reinvention of Tanpura, which Kumarji brought, and she was so fundamental to his music, because in none of the other musicians, perhaps except Mukul, and to some extent Bhimsenji, you could see this Tanpura being omnipresent. Could you just elaborate on it?
Well, Kumarji's music would probably require an independent lecture, because it's so vast, and that wasn't my subject. Kumarji just happened to be the reason for me to look at this, to look at Kumarji's contribution is in many areas which would need to be separately. So I don't know if I want to get into a greater detail or discussion on Kumarji's music. But in relation to the Tanpura, I will make one observation, which was told to me by a friend of mine who was very close to Kumarji. And he was going up to a concert and they asked him, "Bhai, aaj kya gaenge aap Kumarji?" "Socha nahi hai kya gaunga. Tanpura mila lenge. Aur uske baad Tanpura jo kahega wo gaenge." So, a perfectly tuned Tanpura would suggest to him what he should sing on that day. Now, this Tanpura issue, we have to go into the acoustics of the Tanpura and see. I'll have to check the record, specific recordings that you mentioned, and whether I can identify those specific intonations that come out, because the Tanpuras...
Just let me just give you one example. If he has sang Jajare, if there are 17 different recordings of Jajare Kapatikava present, you can find in all these 17 different recordings, 17 different tuning of Tanpura.
Could be.
To give you that effect.
Could
be. That
could be. Could well be.
So that's all. That's exactly
I would need to. Mind. I would need to look at it. I mean, I have friends who have something like... I have friends who have something like 40, 50 different record concerts of the Kumarji. One would need to hear a lot more. And I generally don't discuss a musician until I've studied him very thoroughly. You ask me to talk about Vilayat Khan Saab, I have 400 recordings, almost all of them I know by heart. I can discuss Khan Saab. Amir Khan Saab, every available recording I know by heart. Kesar Bhai, every available recording is with me. These three musicians I can discuss without notice. Any other musician I would need to study and come back.
Thank you.
Very fascinating talk with, like you said, a juxtaposition and a jigsaw of so many ideas. But I'm a trained psychoacoustician and I'm feeling a bit befuddled because I didn't quite understand what you meant by a raga is a psychoacoustic hypothesis. So could you clarify that, please?
Well, I made that statement because raga is basically a melodic manifestation of an emotional idea. Its target response is emotional. I was drawing that analogy from the exact sciences, where you say something where the cause and effect is established with certainty or near certainty, you call it a theory. Here the cause and effect is established with a much lower than 80%, maybe just, I would say, minimum of 50%. So when I perform a rag, I know that I have to put into it not only my musicianship, but extract from the cultural memory as much extra evidence as I can to convert, to improve the probability of achieving the target response that I want. And it is assumed that a pre-composed piece of music I would compare with a theory. It is of non-aesthetic value, non, by and large, non-emotional impact. When you take any symphonic music or even a film song, which is a pre-composed piece of music, it is presented with the conviction that it will have a certain kind of response. I perform a rag with no conviction that it will have the response. I sit down and start performing that rag, drawing on my training and the cultural memory to maximize the probability of getting that response. And a rag never intends to become a theory, because then it becomes a pre-composed piece of music. Rag will always remain, it is a perennial hypothesis. And it's a hypothesis I will test hundreds of times in my life, trying to achieve better than 50%, 60%, 70%. And as I quoted Vilayat Khan Sahib, maybe once in a lifetime, you get close to 70%, 80%, and you feel your life has been validated. That is why I use the word, just as a linguistic statement can be called a psycholinguistic theory, a melodic statement, I would call it a psychoacoustic hypothesis, because it has nowhere near the certainty of the target response.
Sadhus and the wandering ministers when he was recuperating in Devas. Now the question is both to you and Ashok ji, because this book I love very much, of Kumar, that is it that in the process a part of the bhakti was lost when he was trying to restrict it into ragas? The minister had a bigger freedom with the, you know, tones and the notes and so on. Was it becoming more religious or was it becoming more classical music?
First, he ever made an attempt to force rags on them. He let bhajans be bhajans. Whether bhakti came out strongly or not, I don't know. But you can't compare them with bhajans of Kishori Thai, for instance, which are composed in rags, and rags meticulously observed in Kishori Thai's bhajans. Kumarji's was exactly the reverse. It was, the bhajan was the king. Rag may or may not have been there, it was incidental. This is my reading. I could be wrong. Again, I would say I would need to hear his own recordings of 20, 30, 40 to be able to make a confident statement. Aap batayin, sir.
No, not that I know it either. But to me it appears that Kumarji ke mamle mein, ये सही है कि उन्होंने ये तनपटे साधु सुबह निकलते थे, एक बंगले में थे, वो उनका एक फेफड़ा जा चुका था और वो स्वास्थ्य लाभ कर रहे थे। उस दौरान उन्होंने ये सुनना शुरू किया और धीरे धीरे उनको लगा कि मैं राग आया कहाँ से है, ये समझने की कि मुझे एक मुझे एक आधार मिल रहा है। जहां तक उसके धार्मिक होने या न होने का प्रश्न है, कुमार जी अपने आप में धार्मिक व्यक्ति थे और उनके संगीत में वैसी धार्मिकता नहीं है, एक बात। दूसरी बात, एक किस्सा है, वो हरिद्वार गए थे और उन्होंने गंगा के तट पर गाया और भजन भी गाए, तो बाद में साधु जब वो चलने लगे तो साधु उनके पीछे पड़ गए कि हमारे साथ चलिए, हम आपको भगवान का दर्शन कराते। तो कुमार जी ने झुंझला कर कहा कि मुझे किसका दर्शन करना है, मैं तो खुद भगवान हूं। तो ये एक गहरे धार्मिक व्यक्ति का वक्तव्य तो है, लेकिन उस तरह का धार्मिक वक्तव्य नहीं है, तो धर्म विरोधी
वक्त में कहा जा सकता है जिसको साधु लोग बिचारे सहम के भाग गए। ये एक बिल्कुल दूसरा पक्ष। मैं एक बात और कहना चाहता था। एक बार नसीर अमीनी खान डागर साहब से बात हो रही थी, ऐसे ही मैंने पूछा कि आप लोग आलाप लेते हुए ऐसे हाथ क्यों करते। कहा तो सुरों से भगवान की आरती उतारते। मैंने कभी नहीं सोचा था कि हाथ से ऐसा करना आरती उतारने जैसा। तो जो आप अभी कह रहे थे उससे इसका कुछ संबंध जुड़ता है। तरह तरह के रूप, इन सब का प्रयोग रूपकों की तरह किया जाता है। दिस इज अ मेटाफोरिकल लैंग्वेज, इट इज नॉट ए लिटरल लैंग्वेज। इट इज नॉट सेइंग दैट यू आर डूइंग समथिंग literally, but you are doing something metaphorically. Therefore, music can be worship, music can be prarthana, music can be all kinds of other things. Structure, architecture, and all these are metaphorical use of the terms.
Right. Aminuddin Dagar sahab ke baare mein ek vaqia humne suna hai ki kisi ne unse pucha ki bhai aap Malkos mein bhi Sharad Pancham mein Tanpura milate hain. मालकोस में तो पंचम है नहीं, तो आप मध्यम में क्यों नहीं मिलाते? सब गायक तो मध्यम में मिलाते हैं, तो षड़ मध्यम का तानपुरा मिलाते हैं। तो उन्होंने कहा भाई देखो, ये षड़ पंचम का जो रिवाज है वो मंदिरों की घंटियों से मिला हुआ है। षड़ पंचम में मंदिर की घंटियां मिली होती हैं, उससे हम लोग खिलवाड़ नहीं कर सकते। कोई भी राग गाएंगे तो षड़ पंचम का ही तानपुरा मिलेगा। तो ये जज्बात है जो उनके गाने में भी प्रत्यक्ष होता है। अब कान को तकलीफ होती है आजकल के जमाने में षड़ पंचम का तानपुरा हो और मालकों सुने तो, पर वो जज्बात है।
Well friends, with this we come to the end. We are extremely grateful in the Radha Foundation, Mr. Raja, for this remarkably illuminating and provocative presentation on the ragness. In the same series, on the 8th of August, we have a discussion, a conversation in Art Matters in IIC. T.M. Krishna, the well-known Carnatic musician, in conversation with Ananya Vajpayee, who's here today. On 11th August, in IIC, India Habitat Center, we have the Manikal Memorial Lecture being given by Ashish Rajadhyaksh, Reflections from the Very Deep Surface. But I must also tell you that it's going to be another week for Radha Sahib to be not with us for a year. And we have taken him, his body is buried next to his father in Mandla. And Mandla was, Mandla is called Mandla because there's the river Narmada almost forms a mandal around the city. And Radha Sahib was very, very fond and reverential of Narmada. He would never say Narmada. He always said Narmada Ji. So he is buried not very far from Narmada. And one thing which combined Radha Sahib and Kumarji, both departed from the given path. Both had lived not far from Narmada. And therefore, we are having a concert by Kalapini Konkali, Kumarji's daughter, singing Nirgun music on the banks of Narmada. And we are also having a young artist camp painting Narmada. This is not the best season to do it there because it's raining like hell, but we are doing it and we hope that later we'll convert it. multi-arts festival in Mandla in the memory of Lal Sahab. I also like to tell you that as long as he was alive, Lal Sahab did not allow us to do anything in his name. He did not allow Raza Foundation to do anything about him. So everything used to be for others. Now that he is there, we are taking the liberty of doing things in his name. And therefore, we are doing a lot of many things about which you might come to know later. Thank you very much for having me.